Hi, I'm Megan Thomas, a watchable wildlife biologist with the Virginia Department of Wildlife Resources.
And I'm Sergio Harding, an on-game bird conservation biologist with the Virginia Department of Wildlife Resources.
And together, Sergio and I coordinate the Richmond Falcon Cam, which is a live streaming wildlife viewing camera atop the West Tower of the Riverfront Plaza buildings here in downtown Richmond. So the camera is focused on a peregrine falcon nest box atop the tower, and it streams throughout the duration of the falcon's breeding season, which gives our viewers a live look at all the nesting and the chick rearing action that's happening throughout the season. And today is a really, really big day for the Falcon Cam. I'd even go as far as saying it's probably my favorite day of the whole year, because today's the day that we're banding the chicks that we've all been watching develop over the course of the past few weeks.
And we've got 4 chicks this year, which is literally a handful.
Yeah, and because it's such a big day, we wanted to make sure that we gave everybody the opportunity to see all the action that's going on behind the scenes between now and when we turn the camera back on. So with that in mind, Sergio, I think we're just about ready to get started. But before we do, we want to give you a little bit more of a history lesson on peregrine falcon ecology and the species legacy here in Virginia.
So peregrine falcons were extirpated as breeders from Virginia and from the entire eastern U.S. by the mid-1960s due to the effects of DDT and to other factors. They became federally listed as endangered in 1970, and with the banning of DDT in 1972, the stage was set for a comeback. And so the peregrine falcon's decline has turned into a conservation success story. As part of a larger effort across the eastern U.S., around 250 captively bred young peregrines were released in Virginia's coastal plain and mountains between 1978 and 1993. Additional birds have been released annually at Shenandoah National Park since the year 2000, now using chicks hatched at peregrine nests in Virginia rather than captive bred young. Currently, the Virginia peregrine population stands at 32 breeding pairs as of 2020. The majority of these nest on artificial structures in the coastal plain, including hack towers, bridges, power plants, and high-rise buildings, such as Riverfront Plaza here in Richmond. A handful of birds nest at natural cliff sites in the mountains. Now, historically, such cliff faces was where the majority of Virginia's peregrines were known to nest. DWR remains committed to retaining a stable population in the coastal plain. In partnership with the Center for Conservation Biology at the College of William and Mary, while working to reestablish a population in their historic breeding range in the mountains. To that end, DWR has invested a lot of resources in supporting hacking at Shenandoah National Park. Hacking is a tried and true method to safely release young birds at suitable sites. We also monitor known peregrine sites in the mountains and seek out new mountain nest sites. We are having success as the number of occupied mountain sites has continued growing since 2009, and this year numbers around 4 or 5 sites. So, where do the Richmond peregrines fit into this broader conservation picture? The Richmond site was established through hacking of peregrines downtown in the early 2000s, which led to the first successful breeding in 2003. Peregrine falcons are a state-threatened species in Virginia, and so every bird counts, which is why the Virginia population is tracked so carefully through banding, which allows us to follow individuals through time and space. Now, as a whole, the falcons nesting in downtown Richmond have produced 33 young that have survived the flight age. Some of these young have also been hacked at Shenandoah National Park. Many of these have gone on to breed both in Virginia and in nearby states, making their own contributions to the larger peregrine population.
Okay, thanks for that great overview, Sergio. And for those of you who haven't been tuning into the Falcon Cam, I do want to give you just a little bit of background on our current pair of birds. So we've got a banded female, 95 AK, and a banded male, 59 BM. Those are our 2 adult birds in the pair right now. So, you know, for a while here in Richmond, we actually had a pretty long run of the same pair of birds. They bred from 2003 to 2016. But then after 2016, things started to get a little bit more turbulent, and there was a lot of birds coming in and birds coming out. You know, for example, my favorite year, or one of my favorite years, was in 2019. We had a male show up, we had an unbanded female show up. Ultimately, that unbanded female, she ended up getting kicked out by a juvenile female. She's got that really, really clear second year streaky plumage, which looks just so different than the adults do. So this juvenile female showed up on camera, and once she showed up, that other more mature female was out of there. You know, 2020 was another really, really action-packed year. Once again, we had a male, we had an unbanded female. One weekend, we were watching the camera, and we started to see a lot of falcon activity on cam. It ultimately ended up being a new female coming in and getting into disputes, not only with the female already there, but even the male. However, by the end of the weekend, that original female, she was out, and that new intruder female was in. When we got a close look at that female's bands, we were able to find out that she was actually that same female that had been there the year before in juvenile plumage. So she was back this year in her full adult plumage. And that's actually the same female that we have today, 95AK. She was hatched in 2018 from the St. George's Bridge in Delaware. Now, the current male, 59BM, he's got a little bit of a cool story too. He's younger. He was hatched in 2019 in Yorktown. And what's super cool about him is that even though he wasn't hatched in Richmond, the adult female that produced him, she actually bred in Richmond with a different male back in 2017. So in 2017, she was the breeding female that we had on camera here in Richmond. She ended up going to Yorktown, but that's where she ultimately produced our current Richmond male, 59BM. So I think that gets everybody all caught up on our current pair. So with that in mind, let's get back to setting up for banding day.
The first thing we need to do is begin assembling the pen, which the chicks will be placed in after they receive their bands. The pen is 54 inches long by 35 inches wide by 45 inches high to give them plenty of room to stretch their legs and wings, and has been modified to allow the chicks continued access to the nest box. It contains the same gravel mixture, which is inside the box, and will be topped with a wooden roof to provide them with shade and shelter.
We just assembled the pen that we are gonna return the chicks to after they receive their bands. We'll attach this front part down here to the nest box, so it's gonna confine them a little bit. The bright side is everybody will get to still see them on camera, though. They're not going to be hiding all over the place. But most importantly, what the pen does is it prevents any premature fledging events, so we're not running all over the street trying to catch up with a bunch of prematurely fledged juvenile falcons. And then what we'll do once they hit the point that they are developmentally ready to fledge, we will schedule a release on the door so that it'll pop open automatically without us even needing to be there, and they'll be able to leave then.
And the pen kind of mimics the hacking process that takes place on the mountains, which is a means of reintroducing peregrines to their natural habitat. So they're likewise found in an actual box with a front-facing window, similar dimensions, and once the chicks are banded, roughly the same age as we're banding these, you know, they're taken out to the mountains, put in this hack box, they're fed through a hatch door, and when they are developmentally ready to fly, they are released, and then the feedings continue for a few weeks until they're able to hunt on their own.
So we just set up the pen. What we are doing now is we're testing our path out there to see how well we can fit the pen out the ledge door. So that means that we're gonna have staff out there on the ledge, and it also means that we're gonna be turning the live stream off. So this is gonna cut it so that if you are at home watching the Falcon Cam, you are not gonna see anything. So that's what I'm about to do. And that's it. Now it's off. But we'll turn it back on once we return the chicks.
Before we're able to go out on the ledge, we must first put on an assortment of safety gear, seeing as the nest box is located on the 21st story of the tower.
So there's a lot of different safety gear that we have to wear. As you can likely see, we've got hard hats. This is to protect our heads, either if we fell or, you know, the birds can sometimes be territorial. We're out there in their space, so if they were to dive down, this also protects our heads. The other thing that we're gonna have with us is brooms that we will hold up in the air, and that's really important because it puts the broom heads at a higher point. So if they do dive down, they're likely to go for the broom head as opposed to our heads.
The other thing that we're wearing is a fall and arrest harness. In the event of a fall, this will prevent us from toppling over the building.
Yeah, so we've got these straps here that will just clip into a safety feature, basically a pole that runs the length of the ledge, so at all times we'll be secured, so there's no way that we could fall off the side. So I am strapping a GoPro onto my chest so that we can show you guys what it actually looks like to be out on the ledge. It would be way too dangerous to carry a bunch of cameras and all of that to get footage from out there. So this way we can get video of what's happening out there in a more safe way.
After we have all of our safety gear on, it's time to go collect the chicks. We're able to access the outside of the building via a small hatch door, which opens up directly to the ledge where the nest box is located.
Oh yeah, there they are.
I want to take the lead so that I'm not in the shop.
Sure, sure. Yep, there's... Are you going to hold the broom?
Yeah.
All right, we'll be right back.
You're recording, right?
Yep, I'm recording. Oh, there goes an adult.
Yeah, so the higher pitch of the two is the male.
Okay. And here's the camera and a yellow-billed cuckoo. And there's a chick.
Megan, it looks like this camera could use some cleaning.
It definitely looks like it needs some cleaning. We'll make sure we do that while we're out here. We see this cuckoo here too that nobody's been eating.
I see a few cuckoos.
The first chick we secured was behind the nest box, next to the light fixture at the corner where the parapet meets the building. It is important to band chicks between 21 and 35 days after hatching. Chicks collected prior to 21 days are too small to accurately determine their sex, while chicks collected after 35 days are much more mobile and thus more likely to fledge prematurely. After we successfully secure the first chick, we move back towards the hatch door where we locate the remaining three chicks under the lights and a davit arm mount. After the chicks are safely transported in their individual carriers to the inside of the building where banding and data collection will occur, Sergio and I have the opportunity to conduct a quick survey of prey items from around the ledge. Popular prey items of these birds include yellow-billed cuckoos, woodpecker species, and rock doves, otherwise known as pigeons. We also locate some other interesting prey items while on the ledge, such as an American woodcock, a red-eyed vireo, and a species of rail which cannot be identified due to decomposition.
Dead birds coming in.
After Sergio and I are back in the building, it's time to start collecting data and banding the chicks. Each chick receives what we refer to as a field-readable black over green band on the left leg, which is attached via a rivet gun. On the right leg, we use needle nose and linesman's pliers to attach a green federal band, which is then covered with colored electrical tape to help our biologists identify the chicks after they fledge. The tape will fall off naturally in just a few short weeks. At this age, the chicks' legs are fully developed, so the bands they receive today will properly fit them for the remainder of their lives. Banding also allows us to determine the sex of each chick, as females are larger than males and thus receive a larger band. Each chick has its legs sized via a specialized tool. Females wear a size 7A band, while males wear a size 6. After we have determined the sex of the chick and banded it, we take a wing cord measurement and then weigh the chick.
And so as far as the sex ratio with these four chicks, which I know so many people have been wondering about, it was 50-50. We've got two females and we've got two males. Three of the chicks are 29 days old at the time of banding. That was one female and two males. The fourth chick, which was the one to hatch 2 days behind the others, that one is a female. What's pretty remarkable is despite being 2 days younger than that other 29-day-old female, their weights are close to the same. The first female was 1,593 grams. The other is 1,573.
And those aren't actually the net weights. We still have to subtract the weight of the box. From those, which is about 700, so that puts them in the 800 gram range.
Yeah, yep, which is normal. Yep. They all appear to be incredibly healthy. So I think it's great. So now they are. The next step is going to be getting the pen out on the ledge, which is no easy feat, attaching that plywood top to it. And then after that, we're just going to be returning the chicks to that pen. And then after that, we're going to be watching really, really closely because for this particular pair, they have never experienced the pen before. So we'll be watching just to make sure that they're able to get prey items through the bars to the chicks. We are sure that they'll be able to. We've never had issues in the past with it. But yeah, then the chicks are going to be back in the pen until they're old enough to fledge, in which case, or at which time we will set up an automatic door opener, which will pop the door open remotely, and then the chicks will be free to go about their way.
Yeah, and the chicks are at an age now where they're able to feed themselves pretty well, so dropped prey will be eaten by the chicks as opposed to having them rely on being fed by the parents. That still happens as well, but they will be able to take advantage of prey that's prey parts that are dropped.
Staff carefully maneuver the pen to the appropriate spot on the ledge, lining the opening up with the nest box before securely attaching the wooden roof so that it is affixed to the cage. Once the roof is attached, gravel is evenly dispersed around the tray of the pen. Finally, when the pen is completely assembled, it's time to release the chicks inside.
Well, that's it for the day, Sergio. We've got four chicks banded. We've got all the data that we need. They have been returned to the pen out there. We hear the adults, so for all we know, they could be checking them out in the pen right now. So the last step is just to turn the camera back on so everybody can start tuning in again.
So if you would like to do the honors.
And that's it.
All right, let's check this out. Make sure that it's live. And there we are.
Looks good. I see four chicks.
Yep.
Okay, so we've done everything we've needed to do today. We've confirmed that the camera's back on. The next step is going to be for you all to continue watching the Falcon Cam and see what happens. And don't forget, you can always subscribe to the blog to get those updates sent directly to your email.
Thanks to everyone for tuning in today. We hope you enjoyed the video, and the next time you're in downtown Richmond, don't forget to look up. You may just catch a glimpse of the falcons.